गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, टुडेज लेक्चर इज ऑन लिटरेरी डिवाइस सटायर। सटायर इज द यूज ऑफ ह्यूमर, आयरनी, सरकाज्म और रिडिक्यूल टू क्रिटिसाइज समथिंग और समवन। पब्लिक फिगर्स सच एज पॉलिटिशियंस आर ऑफन द सब्जेक्ट ऑफ सटायर, बट सैटरिस्ट कैन मेक एम अदर टारगेट्स एज वेल। From societal conventions to government policies, satire is an entertaining form of social commentary and it occurs in many forms. There are satirical novels, poems and essays, as well as satirical films, shows and cartoons. Satire can be part of a given work or it can be the purpose of an entire text. Now, as we have you must have understood, satire is when we use humor, irony or sarcasm. For what? To ridicule something or someone, to criticize something or someone, just like public figures, politicians, film stars, actors. Mainly they are the objects of satire. But at the same time, the social conventions or traditions can also be a part of satire. They can be a target of satire by the satirist or by the writers who use satire as a device in their works. So, the key features of satire. Satire is a bit unusual as a literary term because it can be used to describe both a literary device and the specific genre of literature that makes use of the device. Just like a comedy is comic because it uses comedy, a satire is satirical because it uses satire. For most of this entry, the word satire will be used, refer to the device, not the genre. Okay, so satire is not a genre, rather satire is a device. Satire often coincides with the use of other literary devices such as irony, malapropism, overstatement, understatement, juxtaposition or parody. So these are the similar devices or the similar words which are used to make a laughter, make an amusement. Though most satire seeks to draw laughter, there are many unfunny or even dark examples of satire such as George Orwell's Animal Farm or Bert Easton's Alice American Psycho, which criticize communist societies and capital societies respectively. So let's move on to the examples. There are a few examples of satire. A very famous example is Alexander Pope's The Rape of the Lock. It is written in the Restoration Age. Alexander Pope's The Rape of Locke is an example of poetic satire in which he has satirized the upper middle class of 18th century England. It exposes the vanity of young fashionable ladies and gentlemen and the frivolity of their actions. For example, here is a phrase, here is a quotation from Pope's Rape of the Lock, where Pope says about Belinda how she feels after losing her lock of hair. Whether the nymph shall break the China's law or some frail China's jar receive a flaw. Whether a nymph shall break Dinah's law or some frail China's jar receive a flaw or stain her honor or her new brocket. So see, he has used two sentences that the nymph shall break Dinah's law. Dinah's law is the law of virginity. Okay, so whether she will break her virginity or some frail China jar receive a flaw, or some frail China jar, some very like fragile, very elegant China jar will receive a flaw, will be broken on the day. So on the one hand there is a chastity of women, on the other hand there is a China jar, and he puts both of them into one place. Just because he wants to show that for these sophisticated young ladies of aristocratic society of neoclassical age, breaking the chastity and breaking the China jar are equally important, or rather breaking the China jar would be a more serious issue than losing the chastity. to stain her honor or her new brocket. What brocket is the brooch which is put on the dress, cloth of which the dress is made, or stain her honor. So whether she will put a stain on her honor or her on her new dress, both are of equal importance. The line marks the values of the fashionable class of the age. The travel things were thought as of equal to significant things. For Belinda, the loss of her virtue becomes equal to a china jar being cracked. Another example is Gulliver's Travels by Jonathan Swift. Jonathan Swift's Gulliver's Travels is one of the finest satirical works in English literature. Swift relentlessly satirizes politics, religion, and Western culture. Criticizing party politics in England, Swift writes that for above 70 moons past, there have been two struggling parties in this empire under the names of Trampskin and Slumpskin, from the high and low heels on their shoes by which they distinguish themselves. So there are two parties, one wears high heels and one wears low heels, and this signifies their rank over each other, that I am more important than you, I am superior than you because I wear high heels, and I am inferior to you because I wear low heels. You are inferior to me because you wear low heels. During Swift's time, two rival political parties, the Whigs and the Tories, dominated the English political scene. Similarly, the kingdom of Lilliput is dominated by two parties distinguished by the size of heels of their boots. But the trivial disputes between the two Lilliputian parties, Swift satirizes the minor disputes of two English parties of his period. So the first, or the Rape of the Lock, is a kind of satire which is humorous, and at the same time it creates laughter. On the other hand, Jonathan Swift writes a serious kind of satire where he satirizes the political parties of his time. And in the same way, George Orwell's Animal Farm is also a satire of serious kind, because he criticizes politics there, and he talks of the Russian Revolution. Now let's move on to the types of satire. So we have different types of satire. First is Horatian satire. It's named after the Roman satirist Horace, who started writing satirical poetry in 35 BC. His aim was largely to entertain with wry humor, wit, and light-hearted mockery, avoiding negativity by refusing to place blame on others or any perceived misgivings. So, the Roman satirist Horace, who started writing satires in 35 BC, his aim was just to entertain people by creating a pungent kind of humor, a light-hearted mockery. So somewhere he had that feeling into his heart that he should not use any kind of negative comments over something, but he talks about the misbehavior of the people. As such, then, the objective of Horatian satire is to be clever and knowing whilst evoking humor by exposing the peculiarities of human behavior. So Horatian satire is very clever in its purpose, because it knows that how much it has to use to laugh at the person whilst evoking humor by exposing the peculiarities of human behavior. While talking about the humor which exposes the flaws of human behavior, a farce or a comedy of errors could both, for instance, have a Horatian feel. But it's not unknown for Horatian satires to splash in satirizing prevailing social attitudes, the way marriage and relationships are perceived in Jane Austen's Pride and Prejudice would be an example of Horatian satire, as is the facile social engagements and light wit contained in Oscar Wilde's The Importance of Being Earnest. Alexander Pope's The Rape of the Lock is an example of Horatian satire that gently mocks the English upper class for its vanity and dim-wittedness. That's it. Though humorous, Horatian satire is the mildest and gentlest form of satire there is. It is not seeking to change the world. It is merely focused on highlighting human folly in all its myriad forms, perhaps through anecdotes and characterization more so than plot, and so its chief purpose is primarily to amuse. Okay, so this is Horatian satire. We does not target at correcting people, rather only on creating humor. Next is juvenile satire. Juvenile satire in literature, any bitter and ironic criticism of contemporary persons and institutions that is filled with personal invective, angry moral indignation and pessimism. The name alludes to the Latin satirist Juvenal, who in the 1st century AD brilliantly denounced Roman society, the rich and powerful, and the discomforts and dangers of city life. Okay, so any bitter or ironic criticism, which is a bit, little bit bitter in taste, of contemporary person and institution that is filled with personal invective, angry moral indignation and pessimism. The name alludes to the Latin satirist Juvenal, who in the 1st century AD brilliantly announced Roman society, the rich and powerful, and the discomforts and dangers of city life. Samuel Johnson modeled his poem London on Juvenal's The Third Satire and The Vanity of Human Wishes on the 10th. Gulliver's Travels established Jonathan Swift as the master of juvenile satire. George Orwell's Animal Farm is again a juvenile satire that is not particularly funny. It ridicules communist government for their total lack of equality. Next comes, so juvenile is a bit sharper than the Horatian satire. Next is Manichean satire. So instead of focusing on societal norms, Manichean satire tends to satirize an individual character flaw and or a particular personality trait, such as a mental attitude. It is less common than juvenile or Horatian satire, though it's the oldest type of satire, taking its name from the Greek philosopher Menippus from the 3rd century BCE. This type of satire is much less aggressive than juvenile satire, but notably more judgmental than Horatian satire. So it is not aggressive as juvenile satire, or not as mild as Horatian satire. Lewis Carroll's Alice in the Wonderland is a Manichean satire in the sense that Alice's curiosity, which ultimately causes her plight. Manichean satire was revived during the Renaissance when it became predominantly a prose and form used to ridicule false learning and false beliefs. Notable examples include Thomas More's Utopia, Francois Rabelais' Gargantua and Pantagruel, and Robert Burns' Alchemy of Melancholy, which is the greatest Manichean satire in English literature. So, here this is all about satire, which says that satire is something which the writer has designed to laugh or mock at. And basically its intention is to criticize whatever is flaws and faults of the society according to the writer. They may not be present in the society, but as per writer, according to the writer, they are the flaws and frailties which fall into the prevailing word. So the similar kind of terms are irony and humor, but satire is a bit different from them. So that's all for the satire. If you have any doubts, any questions, you can ask me into the comment box, or you can send me messages on the WhatsApp group which I made with the third year students. So, and this term is useful for all, not only for third year student, but for other students, other classes as well, and for the betterment of those who wants to learn literature. Okay, thank you very much for your patient listening, and we'll soon meet with another lecture. Thank you very much.